I want to briefly talk in this slide series about the economic geography of China. This is an interesting map, our background slide here. Basically what we're looking at here is a map of the world of Walmart. The countries that are noted here on the map have been sized in proportion to the amount of products that are available on Walmart shelves. So we can see here that China is sized relatively large, and we're probably not too surprised by the fact that a lot of the products available to us at Walmart are from China. Now if we consider or compare the size of China versus the size of the United States, they're about the same size. Now if this is the conterminous United States, so it doesn't include Alaska or Hawaii. Once we add in Alaska and Hawaii, the United States is much larger than China. But if we just consider the lower 48, they're about the same size. Now also note that not only is China and the United States about the same size, but they're also about the same distance north of the equator. So the interesting thing about this map is that we can see where important Chinese cities are located in relationship to other North American cities, and we can also see where the political boundary of China lie in relation to the political boundaries of the United States with regards to their position north of the equator. So we have 30 degrees, 40 degrees, and 50 degrees north of the equator. And so within that 20 degrees, we have the United States, and almost most of China falls in to that realm as well. We can see that Beijing is about the same latitude north of the equator as New York. Buffalo is a little south of Urumqi, and Houston and Chongqing are about the same distance north of the equator. So this kind of gives us an idea of the distance involved in traveling across China. It's traveling to China would be similar to traveling to the United States when they come over here. So United States is a large country, and China is a large country as well. Climatically speaking, they're very similar too. If you consider the southeast part of China matches up pretty well with the southeast part of the United States. That sea climate, the humid temperate climate, tends to dominate southeast China as it does the southeast part of the United States. The western part of China tends to be the upland area, the highland area. It also tends to be the desert area as well. And if you compare the H with the H part of the United States, they're both in the west, more or less. Our Rocky Mountains qualify as the highland portion or the highland climate for us, where the highland climate covers most of the Xizang Plateau and what would be the Himalayas as well. Also, the dry climate, the BWK that you see in the Chinese west, we also have that BWK climate class in the western part of the United States as well. So climatically speaking, China and the United States are pretty similar in terms of their climate class. Even if you look at the humid-cold climate, the humid-cold climate, which tends to be in our north and northeast, is also in their north and northeast as well. So again, China and the United States have some very similar climates in very similar locations, just like the size of China and the size of the United States are relatively similar as well. China is not a particularly homogeneous country. Now, we think of China as being homogeneous in terms of the similar culture and similar language and similar history, and generally the similar background, and so when we broadly consider countries that are homogeneous, China gets put into that group. But let's not make the mistake in thinking that China is just one big happy family. Yes, most of the Chinese are Han Chinese. About 90% of the population or thereabouts are Han Chinese, and so in that regard, it's a pretty homogeneous population. But there's also sizable minority groups out there as well too. There's over 55 recognized minority groups within China that make up about 150 to 175 million people within the population. Now, this is a ethno-linguistic map, a map that basically correlates languages with culture. So obviously we're not dealing with a map that is completely comprised of one color, indicating that everybody is of the same ethnic background and also speaks the same language. Obviously that's not the case. We have a variety of different languages, and the languages tend to correspond one-to-one with the ethnic group. So as you can see in the west, we can see some highland areas in the deserts that are coated white. But we have some Turkic languages, we have some Tajik languages where we're in the Central Asia. But and then the languages become more complex as you reach the coast. So not everyone is going to be fluent in Mandarin Chinese or Cantonese. There's also many other ethnic groups and many other languages that are present within China as well. Now this slide indicates where we're going to kind of branch off and talk a little bit about the economics of China. This is agricultural regions of China. Agriculture is very important for feeding the population of China, which is about 1.4 billion people. We can see that rice is pretty dominant here. If you look in the southeast, where the climate is very good for growing rice, we have several rice growing regions, and we have a little bit of wheat into the north, and then the oasis farming in the deserts to the west. Now, China has a very interesting history when it comes to opium, because it's one of the few global economies, one of the first globalized products was opium. When the British East India Company was moving around the world, it was not only moving people around with it, in terms of slavery and in terms of indentured servants from South Asia, but it was also moving products such as opium around the world as well, too. So the product here in this case is opium. The country of origin is India. The country of destination was China, and the purveyor of this good was the British East India Trading Company. And so this was an interesting company that helped essentially take over the South Asia, basically India, Pakistan, and Bangladesh, and would also be responsible for moving into China as well. And so, as I say on this slide, Britain wanted favorable trade ties with China, and China was very reticent to compromise with the British. And so the British basically instituted a policy where they would try to introduce the Chinese population to opium and then get them addicted to opium, and then that way would they would be a little bit more agreeable if they were high to engaging in some of these trade policies that the British wanted. After the communists took over, they tried a few of the Soviet five-year plans, which did not work out very well for them, ended in starvations and kind of an economic collapse. And so they decided to try these economic zones in which they would allow foreigners to come in and invest within China. But then the Chinese communist government wanted to control where this investment took place. So they identified certain areas along the coast. They created these special economic zones. So the advantages of these special economic zones were that the taxes were low. They had greatly simplified the import and export regulations to encourage people to locate in China along this area. Provided contractual labor, allowed products to be sold on an open market. They also allowed investment by other Asian companies like Japan, Taiwan, and Korea. And then the profits of those companies could return to the investment country. This is just an example of an interchange in the Binhai new area that's being created between Beijing and Shanghai. It's kind of a new growth area. And as you can see, this is a very complicated interchange, and you have some nice modern apartments to the upper left quadrant of this image. And so if you didn't know this was China, you might suspect that this was modern Europe or someplace in the United States, but this is, in fact, is in China. Now there's many companies that have a presence in China, and these particular companies are located in Shenzhen, and we'll have an image of that here later. But you can find Walmart, IBM, Hewlett-Packard, Compaq, Xerox, Merrill Lynch, and McDonald's all have a vested interest in China, and particularly in the Shenzhen, which is on the southeast coast, which I'll highlight here in a few slides. Now, if we look along the Pacific coast of China, we can see where most of the economic development is occurring. This is a prism map where each province within China has been raised according to the gross domestic product of that particular province. So this is in billions of renminbi, the Chinese currency. So we have over 20,000 billion renminbi in the Beijing province and in the Shanghai province. So those are very important provinces within China. So here we have the Guangdong province and the Pearl River estuary. We have Guangzhou to the north, Shenzhen and Hong Kong to the east, and then Macau and Zhuhai, special economic zone, to the west on the western bank of the Pearl River estuary. This is one of the most economically developed special economic zones within China. There are many, many companies, like I said earlier, have a presence within Shenzhen. This is the Shenzhen skyline, very dominant within China. It essentially is a brand new city within the last 20 years or so. Here we have part of the Guangdong province. We have the Hong Kong Shenzhen, highlighted that. Hong Kong, if you remember, used to be a British colony and was given back to China in 2000. Macau went back to China in 1999. Now they're operated with a different set of rules than mainland China, so they can continue to maintain a high level of economic standards within those two provinces. Basically, what we're looking at here now is it's one of the effects of the new money in China, the China's investment within itself. This is the Chinese train to Tibet. This is about it's about a 700-mile long train route that goes from Beijing to Lhasa and the Himalayan uplands. Basically, what the idea is here is to encourage people to travel into the former country of Tibet, to encourage Chinese to move into the Xizang uplands, to settle there, to populate. And basically, this is a way to control the territory and to prevent the Tibetans from perhaps getting their independence back, because once China has fully moved the population, a sizable population of Chinese into this area, it's going to be much harder to relocate them. And basically, this is a way of controlling the territory. It's a way of exploiting the resources. It's a way of economically developing the territory. This is the highest train route in the world, by the way. The passenger cars are compressorized because, if you think about it, we're moving into an upland area, elevations in excess of 12,000 feet, and so you need to have pressurized railroad cars to make sure that you're able to breathe the atmosphere, because you're coming from a very low area in Beijing near the coast. You're probably around elevations that are less than 1,000 feet, to an upland area where elevations are far in excess of 12,000 feet. So it's important that those cars are pressurized. But this is an example of how China is investing in itself and encouraging people to get out and relocate and encourage them to move around. Now, this is an aerial view of the Three Gorges Dam that's being built, or has been built, on the Shangjiang River in central China. This is a very important hydroelectric project. It's the world's largest hydroelectric project to date. The previous one had been in Brazil. This hydroelectric plant is several times larger than Kentucky Lake, the hydroelectric dam at Kentucky Lake. They have lost a lot of their culture. Their cultural artifacts have been inundated. Many cities have been inundated. They've had to move millions of people to accommodate the reservoir behind the dam. This dam has been in progress for about 15 years. It was near it opened in 2003 for generating hydroelectric power, and it should be finished about 2009, which is this year, or 2010. But this is for providing irrigation for crops. It's about providing jobs to the Chinese workforce. It's about providing power to 1.4 billion people, because that's a tremendous necessity for the Chinese people is to have a source of sustainable power for them. Now, reservoirs don't last indefinitely. Reservoirs do have a lifespan. I'm not sure what the lifespan for this one is. The lifespan of Kentucky Dam, in comparison, is probably about 200 years or so, because eventually sediment will pile up behind the dam. And there are ways to go through and kind of dredge that out, but that's only kind of a stopgap measure. Eventually, sediment will fill in behind the dam, and then they'll have to do something else to generate hydroelectric power or to keep that thing going. But it's one of the largest construction projects.